A drip campaign would be the follow-up that now that I've identified myself as interested in that product, the drip campaign is the automated follow-up that now starts to automatically drip me different marketing messages. Typically, most drip campaigns are done automated through email systems. Most email systems, that if you're looking at using these hosted solutions, will actually let you set up that when you've identified this person that they should have campaign A, email goes out 2 days later. Then you can have an email go out 2 weeks later with this video. Then you can have an email go out 6 days later with this link. Then with this customer testimonial. It's a pre-programmed sequence. And you've all had experiences with that because we use it with Maui Mastermind. How many of you have ever downloaded a free book from us? When somebody downloads a free book, Build a Business, Not a Job, first of all, what that puts them on a list that we actually will reach out to them and make a phone call to see if there's something we could do to serve them and if our consulting program would be a fit. As you can imagine, most people we don't even get a hold of, right? Because it's hard to get a hold of people. What happens is, over the next 30 to 40 days, there's a pre-programmed sequence. A certain email goes out that same day. Another email goes out the next day. 3 days later, a video gets emailed to them, a link to a video. 10 days later, it triggers another phone call. And that's all choreographed done. The best drip campaigns are done automatically. The second best are what we call semi-automatic, which means that you have to start them manually, but once you start them, you can forget all about them. And the good thing is once you set it up properly, you don't have to really think about it again. It happens behind the scenes. That's why most of them are email-driven. However, some drip campaigns, and this has been done for a long, long time, are actually more direct mail with combinations of phone calls in there as well. But generally, when we think about a drip campaign in today's world, we think about those automated email sequences. They don't have to feel like a bulk email. It can be a personal feeling email, which means shorter, the grammar's a little bit more informal, not the fancy sales language. It could be simply says, Dear Steve, thank you so much for getting a copy of our free book. I'm thrilled. I hope that you enjoy it. You know what? We love working with business owners that have small businesses like you. I'm going to actually ask one of our team members to follow up with you in the next week or two. His name is his name is Jim Collins, and he'll give you a call and just follow up directly. I've asked him to do that. Again, thank you for getting the book. I hope you enjoy it. Sincerely, David. Does that feel like a sales message? Doesn't it? It feels like a simple, thank you. And so you can set them up to look like a sales message or not. Now, most people who get an email like that know that it's probably an automated email. It's not like you're pulling anything over on anybody, but that's what a drip campaign is. E-letter marketing is just simply a regular outreach to people as you start to build up your email list of what you've got. Two quick notes on email marketing. Number one, you have to regularly email, otherwise the value of that email list diminishes quickly because they'll start to forget that they ever opted in to actually do business with you. In general, I'd recommend at least once every 2 weeks that you send them something, ideally once a week. We do twice a week. Now, you've got to be interesting. These cannot all be sales messages. For us, we do our twice-a-week emails that we go out. They'll typically be about 30 to 50% will have some sales component, and somewhere between 50 and 70% will have much more of a content focus. So we're giving value. Now, if you say, David, what kind of education could we possibly do? If you can't give education, at least be interesting. So here's a quick example. Yeah, I mean, and maybe this is a different way. I mean, you've got, like, for example, I'll use Jeff. You've got the business owners in your community that might want to buy advertising through you to reach the students at these different universities that your studentdollarstretcher.com is going to be a great resource for. There's some educational component that you can do, which is just sharing marketing ideas for them. But you can also do it in the form of, a quick case study here. John Smith that owns the local Taco Bell and Burger King here by it. What he found was he used a really interesting idea to help him with his marketing, blah, 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 blah. Here's what the tick was. I hope this was useful. Quick, fast ideas that help them market for their business would be perfect for you. You can lace in their customer stories, which now gives you a bit of a testimonial aspect. We talked before, Cindy, for your hair salon. I would love to have little video clips, not a fancy thing, although it could be fancy as well. I don't need high production quality. It could be your little video camera or a nicer camera, but you're just pointing out, hey, here's one of the latest trends in hair coloring, and notice how this works, and just sending out, people are going to love that from you, and most of them they're going to ignore, but they'll pick and choose what comes interesting to them. Quickly on your email campaigns, one of the nicest things that they let you do is you can, as you start to build that e-list up, you can start to see what makes people interested about what you have to say. The first thing you can look at is how many people actually open your email. And how many of you have ever heard in the world of direct mail that you should always test your headline? Anyone ever heard that before? What's a headline for an email? Your subject line. So you'll notice sometimes, actually, unless you have your email on our list a couple times, you probably won't notice this. But sometimes we'll send out an A, B, or an ABC split. Well, we'll send out our email, same exact email. The only thing that's different is the subject line. And oftentimes it comes back that there's no difference. One's a 10% open, one's a 9.8% open. That's frustrating. But sometimes we'll come back and one's 2, 3, or 4 times better response for what was opened. So you can use your email marketing to actually help you to discover what words really are more attractive, so that when you go to do the more expensive paid advertising that you might do, you're using those words to have had some testing with it. It used to be the same thing that you do in direct mail, where you would test these things through classified advertising. Email lets you do that fairly inexpensively. You can also see what captures their attention inside the email by tracking links. Most of these services, if you were to use, will let you track links so you can see which links actually caught people's attention. You know, if you have a special offer and you put off, you know, let's say you have a list of 2,000 people. Small e-list probably for most businesses. You special offer, it says buy one, get one free. Another special offer to the same offer, it simply says get 50% off. What's the difference? I don't know. We'll see which one comes out better. Sometimes just by changing the way you phrase the exact same thing works better. You know, we've tried it with risk reversal before. We've had guarantees that have said unconditional, you know, money-back guarantee. If you're not thrilled for any reason, return it. And we've had other guarantees that have said, if you don't think it's going to make you at least 10 times as much money as you paid, return it for a free refund. Which is better? Depends on the offer, but oftentimes the second one's better. But which is really better? An unconditional guarantee means even if you think it would only make you, you know, even if you thought it would make you 10 times more money, if you still wanted to return it, you can do that, right? So it's crazy, but sometimes just by the way you phrase it, and email marketing helps you to do that. So we're going through these quickly here. Unconsummated transactions are for those times when someone starts to buy, but the transaction gets interrupted. This could be someone who comes to your counter and puts the things on the counter and walks away without paying for them. Not taking, but leaving them on the counter. This could be that how many of you have ever gone to a grocery store and had your kids throw a fit and had to leave the grocery store? I'm the only one. Okay, Jeff's raised his hand. Chad, okay, got a couple parents. I guess the four of us have kids that are not as well behaved as the rest of you. Because, I mean, our kids sometimes will, like, go different directions in the grocery store, and they'll start grabbing candy or food and start eating it. And it's like, you know, you have a choice here right now. We can either leave right now and sometimes they choose to leave the store right away. And so you'll abandon the cart. That's an unconsummated transaction. In the world of online shopping, an unconsummated transaction is an abandoned cart. Hey, I put these items in, I showed that I wanted to buy, but I never finished the purchase online. So a marketing strategy could be to outreach those people who have abandoned the shopping process, to reach out and say, hey, I noticed that you started this purchase here. I understand that maybe something on the site broke down for you. I understand maybe it was difficult. We wanted to follow up with you and make sure that we didn't do anything that made it difficult. How can we help you? We're so sorry. By the way, we wanted to give you 10% off just for having the trouble of working with us. It didn't work well. Referral systems we talked about. These are not word of mouth. These are structured, thought through, formal systems to prompt your customers and clients to actually refer other people to you. And then the last one there on the internal says leveraging your marquee clients. These are the people that in your industry are the influencers that Sam Smith is a customer of yours, it has a lot of weight with other people. If this company is a customer of yours, it has a lot of weight with other people. So leveraging your marquee clients is another marketing tactic. So what I want you to do right now is write down any of the other marketing that you do that are to your current customers or people who are in your database. What were some of the other ideas you have? Write them in there in the blank spots. Jumping down to external marketing systems, you have SEO, which stands for what? Search engine optimization. Paid search, typically we mean by that pay-per-click types of advertising, where you're using it whether it be Google or through Yahoo or Bing. Jeff gave a great description of exactly what I did that yesterday. Online listings or ads. This might be you know, paying to be listed in a particular website, or paying for either a link or paying for a banner ad. Social media, you know, getting your presence there on Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn, or one of the other sites, depending on what you're trying to accomplish. Video and article marketing. For many of your businesses, this is probably a good thing for you to consider doing. You know, putting out there some kind of educational, informational, or for some businesses, entertainment that you can put out there into the world that will generate PR value for you. And there are actually services where you can submit your articles or submit your videos to that will get them wider distribution. Next, you have white papers. For those of you who have more professional types of practices, you know, you're not going to probably want to just think about an article. Sometimes by actually writing or getting and commissioning a third party who has a little bit more perceived credibility and impartiality to produce a white paper, it's a wonderful way to do the marketing. For example, so Steve, you've got your lighting solutions here. If you were to write the paper, you were to write something that said an article about how your patented lighting solutions can save a building 93% of its expense, people are going to read that, and some are going to say, well, that's great. Some are going to say, I'm a little bit jaded here. This is the guy who runs the company. This is a piece of marketing, not necessarily accurate truth. But if some third party, you know, an academic or somebody else, produces a white paper about different lighting solutions that can reduce expenses and be good for the environment, and one case study in there is about Firefly LED lighting and how it can actually, you know, but because of the way it has a patented technology of how it dissipates heating and so forth, it actually can reduce expenses by this amount. One is actual editorial content. It's actually the content of the newspaper, so to speak, versus the advertisement of the newspaper has greater credibility. Those tend to work more for people who are selling to a little bit more of a professional environment, I guess I'd put out there. Then you've got viral marketing campaigns. Those are tough to produce, but those are the ones that you see in your email box that all your friends say, you've got to see this video. Or the campaigns where, here's a great example of a viral marketing campaign. How many of you have recently been on Facebook where they offer to tell all your friends about your and invite all your friends in your contact manager about Facebook to get them to become friends with you? Just one touch of a button and you get everybody else on there. You see this in other websites, right? Those types of campaigns where they're trying to get the people who are in the business to spread the word, almost like the quote-unquote virus that's going viral with that. Pretty powerful when it works. Not always so easy to design and do. Telemarketing is pretty straightforward. It's actually making phone calls to people to generate business. Print advertising, I mean, we forget about that in today's world, but still a lot of business can be generated through print advertising, whether it's in a magazine or a newspaper or a newsletter. Especially nowadays, they've got the ability for how to do the printing that you can actually go much more regional or even local, where once upon a time you'd have to go in a much larger, because of the way they did the printing, you'd have to go with a much larger, more expensive area. Trade shows, let's not forget about conventions and conferences. Blogging, where you're doing your writing online in such a way, whether it be on your blog or on other people's blogs. Or it could also be you posting on other people's blogs, comments, and adding to the conversation in a meaningful way with links back to your site. Signage, physical location, make sure you put a dot by that one. Most people, when they think about their businesses, forget about how powerful and leveraged signs are. You know, just a simple thing like an A-frame sign out in front of your business, or good signage if you're you get on the main road, making sure it's part of your lease that you've negotiated. Sometimes you can even be something fancier, like I know, Kimberly, you're about to put a great big digital sign out in front of a busy street for your dental practice. So signage is usually fairly inexpensive in relationship to a lot of people. We're talking, where's Cynthia at? There we go, Cynthia and John. So John's got a commercial fishing business that he's just launching here. They've got a lot in Kauai that's right on a main bike path by the coast. Well, that would be a perfect place to put a, you know, you're not doing anything with a lot right now, as long as you're not going to, you know, go against some local ordinance, but getting a great big sign up there, even if it costs you $2,000-$4,000 to do a really nice sign, it's one-time expense, and to maintain it is probably nothing for a couple of years until it needs to be painted or resurfaced or something. You can oftentimes even do it less expensively, but signage, if you've got physical locations, it makes great sense to take advantage of that. Next, you've got down here outside sales reps. So do you have a service that you can get other people to sell it for you? Andrea, for your business, that's one of your best marketing tactics. You've got your reps in Oahu and on Maui and Kauai that are selling your things into the stores. Resellers. VAR stands for value-added resellers and channel partners. Quick examples of what that might be. I mean, how many of you have recently bought a computer? Like, for example, let's say you bought a Lenovo computer or a Sony computer or an HP computer. You've bought those computers, but you didn't realize that they were actually a value-added reseller or channel partner with whom? Probably like Microsoft, like your operating system was in there. So they, you know, most of the Microsoft doesn't sell its Windows products or whatever it is. They don't really sell it directly to the consumer for the operating system nearly as much as they sell it through the makers who make the computers that go out there at a discounted rate for that. So that's an example of that. Email, pretty self-explanatory. Catalog marketing, if you've got a product or even a service in some cases that would go well where you might either put your own catalog out or you might pay to place your product in somebody else's catalog. So for example, if you look at, how many of you have recently looked at the Sky Mall types of magazines? You know, you pay, it's pretty expensive, but you pay to place your product there in that catalog. Generally, if you're paying to place in somebody else's catalog, you're taking your very best, we call gateway product, the few products or services you can put up there that will generate somebody so that they buy, even if it's at a break even or even a loss, because now you've acquired a customer that you can now market all your other stuff to without having to pay for that expensive part of someone else's placement. Live events. I have two different versions of live events, self-promoted and other promoters or groups. And we don't even think about this, but how many of you in your businesses have ever used speaking at a conference or a panel discussion that you were speaking at? It's a great marketing aspect because you're presented as an expert. How many of you promote your own events that you do for yourself or for your target market? It's another great way of doing it. Clearly, we do that with Maui Mastermind. Depending on the business, it can be really successful. Press releases is another way. How many of you ever use PR to generate more business for you? You know, I've had businesses have great success. I've had businesses have had lousy success with that, but that's a possibility. Directories, again, where you're paying for placement or even just paying for someone to take the time to put you in all these free directories. Canvassing means going and actually knocking on doors. It means you're actually going to places of business or going to homes and actually saying hi. It's basically a cold call in person. Renting traffic. This is where you're paying to put yourself in a place where somebody else has already generated the traffic. Example, this might be a store within a store. Like, for example, you go to a store and they have a small kiosk inside the store how many of you have ever seen like now that you have a local bank that has a small little office or a bank outlet inside of a grocery store? It's an example of a store within a store. They're renting the space. The bank pays the grocery store a certain amount of money because they know that they have all the convenient traffic there to generate more accounts for them and to really kind of help with market presence in a community. Tires and door hangers, example of guerrilla marketing there. Outdoor advertising would be things like your billboards, your bench ads. Lead exchanges are where multiple businesses get together and actually trade leads back and forth. Examples of that. A great example would be catalog companies. Most direct mail catalog companies are part of a lead exchange that a third party actually does this. This is the formal way, where that if you're J. Crew, you can give 100,000 leads or 500,000 leads into that lead exchange and get 500,000 fresh leads that you didn't have before that you can start doing targeted marketing. Because they know that when you buy from J. Crew, you're likely to also probably buy from Land's End or from one of these other catalogs. And they recognize that it's not necessarily a bad thing, because it gets, even if they might lose a little bit of business with their current people through competition, they're going to get something net more. Another example informally of lead exchanges are when like businesses get together in one place. How many of you have ever seen that fast food restaurants tend to accumulate on a corner where there might be 7 or 8 within a very tight configuration? And part of you thinks, well, why would they want to do that? Because net effect is they all get more traffic that way than if they only had 1 or 2 of them there, because more likely that people go. That's an informal example of it, but lead exchanges where you can create a reciprocal relationship with other people to trade leads. Referrals, networking groups. You know, maybe it might be a matter that, you know, once a month you get together with a group that has a networking meeting that you all trade leads for each other. The informal types of networking groups like the Chamber of Commerce that you go to, or the Kiwanis Club that you go to, or some of the other associations that you might belong to. Television is self-explanatory. Inserts tend to be inserts, things like an insert in a newspaper, an insert in a magazine. But there are also insert campaigns where you put your marketing materials in other people's direct mail pieces. For example, how many of you have ever got solicitations with your credit card statement? It's an example of an insert. You know, you might have to pay 10, 15, 20 cents per time that goes out, but it's a lot less expensive, and you're almost assured that someone's going to open it. Now, they might ignore the little envelope tear-off, but so those are examples of inserts. Radio is pretty straightforward. Affinity marketing channels, to be an example about this one here. So she's got her beautiful jewelry that she's got. She wants to intelligently find a new way of selling her jewelry. She used to have a store or physical location, doesn't have it anymore. So an affinity marketing channel would be for her to find other people who already have great relationships with the client base that she wants. So for example, maybe putting on a small micro event where she goes and finds a health, you know, beautiful day spa with maybe this type of clothing person, you know, very high-end stuff that they get together to throw an evening party. It's exclusive to just each of the people bring, you know, 20, 25 of their best customers. Exclusive, there's just wine there, it's a nice ambiance, it's in a beautiful spot, and right there is available are the jewelry and the clothing and the day spa, so they can kind of sign up for future services there. And they all benefit by bringing in new customers that they never would have known, and they bring some of theirs as well. So they now get introduced to maybe, you know, five times new customers for what the customers they're bringing there. Be an example of an affinity marketing channel. Convenience marketing channels are, you know, back when the business I used to do, we knew that there would be lots of people at a particular event. So we would go there and put flyers out on all those cars. We're taking advantage of the traffic that somebody else went and did. You have to be careful about that one there, certainly, but it's something to consider as a guerrilla marketing tactic. And then joint ventures, are you working with some outside business or party to somehow work where they get something and you get something to work together? Whether it's a direct, you're paying them for that, or you're going to split revenue, or you're going to let them market to your people, you market to their people. Be an example of a joint venture. Maybe you're going to do an event together. Dennis talked about with his law firm. He's going to team up with a particular financial advisor, and the two of them are going to put on some joint events. Now, right there, he's got a way to half his cost or double his attendance if this other person does just what he does. There's a downside to it, right? He's going to have some dilution of his message. But if you choose the right joint venture partner where they're going to reflect well on you, and they're non-competitive, you should have a net gain if it's done properly. So these are all kinds of ideas here, and these aren't all of them. Matter of fact, next I'm going to give you a moment here to write down more ideas that you might have in here for your business. And I'm going to give you guys 5 minutes to do the following here right now. Write in more of the ideas that you have, and then what I want you to do is to come back to this idea of low-hanging fruit and home runs, and any of the ideas that you put a tick mark by, that you said this is applicable to our business, and you have, you know, 30 or 40 different ideas here, maybe only 20 or 25 are applicable to your business, I want you to go through and please pay close attention to what I'm about to tell you right now. What I'm about to share with you is the single most important piece of advice I can give you about actually making a sweet spot analysis work. After working with thousands of businesses, this is what most business owners screw up when they use a sweet spot analysis to make it worthless. If you follow what I'm about to tell you, you will make a sweet spot analysis one of the most powerful tools to make smart, leveraged decisions inside your business. Do I have your attention now? So most business owners, what they'll do is they'll go through and evaluate idea number one, trade shows. Is it a low-hanging fruit? Nope. Is it a home run? Maybe for my business, maybe I... They'll ask both questions sequentially about the idea. That is clearly and categorically the wrong way to do it. Everyone hear that? The effective way to do it, after having done this for over a decade, we've been using this tool, is to go through every idea on the list and ask, is it a low-hanging fruit? 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 To do that, play through the list completely. Any that are a low-hanging fruit, tick the box here on your tool. When you've gone through your entire list of the ones that you marked that were applicable for your business, stop, shake, and go back through the list and now ask what question? Is it a home run? 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 Don't try to mix the two. It's like driving with the foot on the gas and the brakes, like my sister Lori does. Just jerks your neck around. we don't do well when we try to switch with that one. So low-hanging fruit, it means, is this an idea that would be easy to do or would be a very high likelihood of working? Is this a low-hanging fruit? A home run simply means, if this works, is it going to be big? And maybe you say for you, trade shows, you know, if it works, it's not going to be that big. Great, it's not a home run. Next one, blogging. You know what, if it works, not going to be big for us, not a home run. Signage, if it works, that one actually could be big for us because we have a physical. And Cindy, your business, first time people to your salon. So you just go through the whole list. Is it a low-hanging fruit? Then second time through, is it a home run? The LH stands for what? Low-hanging fruit. The HR stands for home run, and go through your list that way. So I'm going to give you 5 minutes, and I'll check to see where you are. We might give you a little bit more time outside of that. I want you to go through all the ideas again, asking first for low-hanging fruit and then for home run. Question for you, it's a trick question, so I'm preparing you for it. Which column do you mark the sweet spot on? None. How do you know it's a sweet spot? Because you've got it ticked off on two columns there, that it's both a low-hanging fruit and the column that says home run. Later on, you don't have to go and see which ones are the sweet spots. They'll automatically appear because you have two check marks side by side. Make sense? So you never ask, I'm going to be clear here, you never ask, is this a sweet spot? You simply ask, is it a low-hanging fruit? And then you ask later on, the second time through, is it a home run? And the sweet spots magically appear once you've asked those other questions. Does that make sense? 5 minutes, go.